In the last episode, I briefly looked at the McFarlane Burnet Centre in Melbourne and its new building. And the International Health Unit of the what is now called the Burnet Institute, and the role that the International Health Unit are playing in spreading propaganda on behalf of the American immunology and virology establishments about the cause of AIDS and what best should be done about it, and that the funding for the Institute in the period from 1997 to 2000 came from public money from the state government and the federal government. The federal government through the National Health and Medical Research Council, up to a total of about $4 million a year, and then corporate donors, including HIH Wintartha Insurance and Rio Tinto Mining, Rio Tinto being a British-based company that are named after a Spanish gold area. And the British Rio Tinto company have major interests in Aboriginal-owned land. And in land owned by indigenous people throughout the areas in which the McFarlane Burnet Centre are doing their health promotion, or what ostensibly goes as health promotion, and is sponsored by a whole range of largely church-related aid organizations, international aid organizations, including World Vision, also the Red Cross, the Australian and international branches of the Red Cross, and AusAid, which is the Australian government's official international aid fund. And also is got grants and jobs from the United Nations, World Health Organization, UNAIDS, and also USAIDS. And the director of the Institute during this time of relocation was an American-trained microbiologist by the name of John Mills, who was simultaneously the director of the Rothschilds Bioinvestment Fund Managers Group and AMRED Biotechnology in Melbourne, and he was also an adjunct professor at the University of California in America, and also an honorary professor of microbiology at both the University of Melbourne and Monash University. University of Melbourne and Monash University, and that's Professor John Mills, are the only two universities that are allowed to train undergraduate medical students in Victoria, and one of a handful of universities in Australia. The University of Melbourne was built around 1860 at the time of the gold rush. And as you will see from the maps of the University of Melbourne, the mining industry developed hand in hand with the medical industry from the earliest days of Victoria. And Victoria itself being named after Queen Victoria, who was then a young queen in 1851. The institutions that were established at that time have continued to maintain a royalist affinity, but also a Masonic affinity. You can see here that John Mills was at the time the director of AMRAD and Rothschild's Biosciences Managers Limited. This was the 2000 board of directors of the Macfarlane Burnet Centre. That's Lady Primrose Potter. Then a representative from New Farm, and Nicholas Saunders is the dean of the, or was the dean of the Faculty of Medicine of Monash University and chair of the NHMRC. You'll notice that the Macfarlane Burnet Centre uses advertising advice from the brochure and the fold-out section in the 2000 brochure on glossy paper with corporate gifts from all of these companies, and then various schools and community organizations. The Ian Potter Foundation, and you notice Lady Primrose Potter on the board of directors, Tattersall's Holdings, etc., etc. Then Dame Elizabeth Murdoch, who I sent a, or delivered a copy of my thesis to last week, donated $50,000 or more. Dame Elizabeth Murdoch is, of course, the Melbourne-based mother of Rupert Murdoch, who owns HarperCollins as well as the Age newspaper, as well as the Herald Sun, and is a powerful Australian-American media mogul, owner also of Fox Television and Fox Film Studios. And you'll see there may be a relevance in the Simpsons pictures that you will see being promoted in one of the annual reports. This is the self-promotion of Mike Toole, the director of the International Health Unit. I met Mike Toole about 4 years ago in St. Kilda when I was busking there, and asked him about why he thought that there was an epidemic of AIDS affecting young women in New Guinea. And he told me that his opinion, and I take this to be the opinion of the center, given that he's the director of the International Health Unit, is that the reason that there was an epidemic in New Guinean women is that the men were raping the women. And he told me that he regarded the same as the reason that there's an epidemic in South Africa, and stated to me that 1 in 2 South African women were raped. Now, you can see Mike Toole was a health specialist on a feasibility mission to develop phase 2 of the Laos HIV response and many other projects. This is the site of the Alfred Hospital, right in the heart of Melbourne, and prime real estate. Punt Road, which is a continuation of Hoddle Street, notorious for the Hoddle Street massacre, or shooting of the, I think it was the 1980s. And you'll notice that the American consulate is adjacent, with only the hospital staff allowed between the American consulate and what was the Baker Research Institute adjacent to and the Alfred Hospital complex. The Victorian School for Deaf Children adjacent. And you'll see Alfred Street, and a Uniting Church just north of the Alfred, and Faulkner Park. They have a helipad, and that's Commercial Road. Tram 72, and what used to be the Hamilton Russell House and Margaret Cole's house has now been replaced, or demolished and replaced, by the new AMREP, or Alfred Medical Research and Education Precinct, which houses the McFarlane Burnet Centre, or now the Burnet Institute, and the Baker Foundation. The Baker Foundation is a heart research institute which is focused on cholesterol-lowering drugs, which are the biggest, amongst the biggest expenses in the health budget, or the pharmaceutical budget. That includes Pravacol, which was, and the cholesterol-lowering statin agents, Zocor and Pravacol. And these drugs were being produced by AMRAD, which was John Mills's company. And AMRAD were in a joint venture to build new offices and laboratories in what was the Burnley Agricultural College, after it was acquired by the University of Melbourne. And AMRAD produced cholesterol-lowering drugs, or did at that time. This is a map of Yarra Bend, And here you can see the Fairfield Infectious Diseases Hospital and the Fairley Women's Prison. Both of these have now been demolished, and the Fairfield Infectious Diseases Hospital site has been converted to a high security psychiatry prison. They call it forensic mental health, forensic meaning law related. These used to be called asylums for the criminally insane, but of course even the word asylum, being a safe place, is a misnomer, because these were prisons for people who were judged to be criminally insane. It also included people, and still includes people, who are held at what they call the Governor's Pleasure or Her Majesty's Pleasure in Queensland. These are people who haven't broken the law, but are being held indefinitely without trial under the claim that they could commit criminal offences if they were released. This is the propaganda of public health, public information about their plans to maintain the AIDS Memorial Garden at the site of the forensic mental health development. This development went ahead in the late 1990s, and the subject land is the site of the new asylum or prison. The women who were at Fairley Prison have been taken out and locked up in a new prison at Deer Park. The Victorian Institute of Forensic Mental Health consists of a 120-bed hospital facility and a 15-bed disability services residential facility to be built on part of the former Fairfield Infectious Diseases Hospital. Now, Yarra Bend was previously the site of John Batman trading at the junction of Merri Creek and Yarra Bend, or the Yarra River at Yarra Bend, with the Aboriginal people. He gave them looking glasses and handkerchiefs and blankets and alcohol and tomahawks, and said that he would come and live there with his seven daughters and his cattle and pay rental to them for their land. But John Batman's treaty, as it was called, with three Aboriginal men who all call themselves Jigga Jigga, Jigga Jigga, and Jigga Jigga, was held to be invalid by the Port Phillip Committee from Adelaide, who were almost certainly a Masonic group. They made Batman buy back land from them and confiscated the rest of the 600,000 acres and continued to maintained that Australia was terra nullius and no one's land. And meanwhile, they encouraged the creation of a white colony and the continued genocide of the Aboriginal people. This was, of course, a continuation of genocide all over the colonized world by the British Empire, and began when Captain Cook first arrived in Australia with a supply of smallpox. The Murdoch press in particular frequently publish articles that promote the idea that there is a lot of depression and suicide in our society, and that more psychiatric treatment and diagnostic services and research are needed into why depression, suicide, schizophrenia, attention deficit disorder, etc., and various psychiatric labels are so common and apparently increasing. The World Health Organization itself has predicted that after doing an extensive study on global disease burden, that psychiatric illness will increase as a major cause of disability throughout the world over the next 20 years. This is a photograph, and you can see the reflection of my video camera too, of the prison that they have built in the old Fairfield Infectious Diseases Hospital and the previous site of the McFarlane Burnet Centre. That's the view that the prisoners would have if they could see through the tall fence that's built around the facility. And this is their claim that they were going to do indigenous revegetation and create a wildlife corridor for native animals in what was previously the site of the Yarrabend Asylum, built as early as 1848 in anticipation of the gold rush, which was permitted in 1851 when the government offered a reward for the discovery of gold. Up till 1851, people who discovered gold were locked up in prisons. And then in the new asylums. And the first was at Yarrabend, followed by shortly afterwards in the 1850s and 1860s at Bendigo and Ballarat, the two other major gold mining cities or towns in Victoria. Here you can see the location of the Alfred Hospital and Burnet Institute in Windsor at the junction of Punt Road and Commercial Road and St Kilda Road. And there's the Royal Freemasons Homes of Victoria. Alfred himself was a Mason and was Queen Victoria's husband, who was a member of the Coburg dynasty of Germany and Belgium, and King Leopold of Belgium, after whom who founded the Prince Leopold Institute, named after his son, was the previous colonial owner of the Belgian Congo, or Zaire, where the AIDS epidemic appeared in the late 1970s and early 1980s. There you can see Prince's Bridge, Queen's Bridge, King's Bridge, all named after different members of Queen Victoria's family. Followed by various European or British discoverers of Victoria. Of course, Victoria had been discovered over 40,000 years earlier by the Aboriginal people. There you can see the ICI building at the corner of Albert Street and the State Houses of Parliament and Treasury Gardens. ICI is Imperial Chemical Industries, founded by the British in 1929, the same year as the British Broadcasting Corporation. And ICI was designed to coordinate all chemical production, including chemical warfare agents and agricultural chemicals, explosives, ammonium nitrate, and mining products for the British Empire after the First World War. And this is the Freemasons Hospital. Immediately opposite is the Red Cross headquarters, Dallas Brooks Hall, and this is the headquarters of the Freemasons in Victoria. The Dallas Brooks Hall and the Masonic Center adjoining it are owned and run by the Freemasons, along with the Freemasons Hospital. Now, the Red Cross was founded by Henri Dunant during the Crimean War, and he was a Swiss Freemason. The Red Cross order itself and the commander of the Red Cross is a Masonic order of the Swedish, the highest order of the Swedish royal family. There you can see Dallas Brooks Hall, which houses the Masonic Library. This is East Melbourne, and then further east is Richmond, with Burnley Street running north. Now, if you follow the railway line that travels east, you can see Church Street and Mason Street. The development around Albert Road and the Albert Park Lake and Albert Park itself reflects the Masonic idea of having a good time, which was to play golf and sail in yachts, and subsequently to watch people driving around fast in cars. They also had an interest in the old British games of the boys, which were cricket and various codes of football. They looked down on soccer and they looked up towards various codes of rugby union, rugby league, and in Melbourne became very parochial about what they call Australian rules. Dallas Brooks himself, after whom Dallas Brooks Drive and the Dallas Brooks Hall are named, was a Masonic governor of Victoria. Now you can see other names that are named after landowning families, members of the royal family, and back to the Alfred Hospital. Now, that's a close-up view of Melbourne City itself, with the Royal Exhibition Building, Carlton Gardens, and you can see who owns the most valuable land of the 600,000 acres that Batman traded for some tomahawks, looking glasses, and blankets, not forgetting four red shirts. Now, you can see in this map the location of the various Commonwealth offices and the postal services and the police stations, as well as the location of Tattersall's Lane and the various churches in the city itself, as well as the court system and their proximity to the National Australia Bank, as well as the ABC Radio, and the Peter McCallum, one of the previous location of Peter McCallum, Cancer Institute or Peter McCallum Hospital. Now, Peter McCallum was the headquarters of the radiation and nuclear medicine research. In other words, they had access to radioisotopes or nuclear material and were in charge of cancer treatment. Since the development of radioactivity was first marketed in Australia. And Australia was recognized as a source of uranium, along with Southern Africa. Now, if you look at the location of Queen Victoria Market, established in 1878, you can imagine something of why or how the development of Melbourne and the key institutions of Melbourne developed as people tried to control the drunken or the Masons and the British authorities tried to control the drunk young men who were flocking to the gold fields. And this was on top of what was a prison colony. And so they were trying to control people who they had already labeled as being criminals. Now, MacArthur Street is probably named after John MacArthur rather than Douglas MacArthur, who was a prominent landowner and amongst the so-called exclusives or free settlers who claimed Batman's land or the Aboriginal land that had been stolen by Batman in what was a notorious system of false treaties that the British engaged in all over the world to try and pay lip service to what was then international law. This is back in the 1700s. International law that one was not allowed to claim land that was already occupied. Australia had already been identified and named by the Dutch as New Holland. So for Captain Cook and his Masonic masters and the British Crown to claim Australia when the indigenous people had been living here for over 40,000 years and trading for thousands of years with the people of the Dutch East Indies, or what were then called the Spice Islands, is obviously was even by those terms of the day, an illegal act, which is why Captain Cook was given secret orders that he was supposed to open only after he had observed a conjunction of stars in the Philippines. That's because three quarters of the Australian coast, the south and the west and the east, south and the west and the north, had been mapped by the Dutch. Here you can see Royal Park Hospital and or the Royal Park Children's Hospital, the Royal Children's Hospital, and the Royal Park itself and Parkville. Directly across to the east of Royal Park is the University of Melbourne. north of Royal Park is the Royal Park Hospital, and south is the Royal Melbourne Hospital, Royal Dental Hospital, and here you can see the University of Melbourne. On the right, and Royal Parade running north. Royal Parade is an extension of Elizabeth Street, named of course after the current Queen Elizabeth, but then the Princess Elizabeth. And all these royal institutions, of course, refer to the British royal family. And here you can see Mason Road and Monash Drive in the grounds themselves of Monash, of the University of Melbourne. Here, heading north to Brunswick Road, which becomes Sydney Road and becomes the main highway, or the Hume Highway, to Sydney. If you then head west from Sydney Road, is the Royal Park Golf Course, and adjacent to that the Mount Royal Special Hospital for the Aged, the CSL, the Commonwealth Serum Laboratories, Tirana, which is a youth detention centre, and the Royal Park Hospital, where I was first locked up with a diagnosis of hypomania back in 1995 when I criticized the Victorian psychiatric profession. The Royal Park Hospital is the location also of, or was the location of, the Mental Health Research Institute, headed by Ben Lochtenberg, the boss of ICI or Orica, and also the boss of University of Melbourne Private, a member of the Eastern, Inner and Eastern Healthcare Network, and that's the Royal Automotive Club of Victoria, or RACV, publication from 1993. If you look at those maps again carefully, you'll also see a range of other Masonic plans, and this includes the Monash, what became the Monash Freeway, but back in 1993 they had planned to build a Monash Highway along a different route, which basically connected a whole bunch of golf courses and hospitals along a direct route from Monash University to the Prince's Highway. Now, the Prince's Highway is the highway that runs right around Australia, and the Dandenongs are the southern reaches of the Great Dividing Range, which runs all the way up to North Queensland. The Great Dividing Range is a volcanic range, and the most southern points of the Great Dividing Range are actually not here in Melbourne, but further west of Melbourne, where there are volcanoes at the Otway Ranges, and further west on the route to South Australia and Adelaide. Mount Napier exploded in the last volcanic eruption only 8,000 years ago, when Aboriginal people had already been living in the area for over 30,000 years. And the oral tradition of the Aboriginal people preserves memories of how the land has changed in its structure. And the oral tradition, and also the names of various sites along the road to Adelaide, including Massacre Point, Massacre Creek, and Massacre Swamp, indicate the history of massacres of Aboriginal people in Victoria before the time of Federation. And these massacres were never documented at the time by the authorities, and often they changed the names of massacres or tried to change the names of these significant sites of massacres to disguise the massacre by naming it after shipwrecks or other less contentious historical events or less disturbing historical events. This is Monash University, and you can see the location of the medicine department, which is largely administration. It's very hard to find any doctors in the medicine department at Monash. Most of them are in private practice or at working at the Monash Medical Centre in Clayton. Here you can see the Monash Highway plan from 1995, running along what was and still is North Road. In fact, the Monash Freeway is a been developed differently since the wish list of the Royal Automotive Club of Victoria in 1993. Florey Court is named after Howard Florey, who was also a Freemason, and of course the famous co-discoverer of penicillin, along with Alexander Fleming. He has an institute named after him as well at the University of Melbourne, the Howard Florey Institute, which is also involved in, continues to be involved in drug development, and also brain research. You'll see when we look at the annual reports of the Mental Health Research Institute that one of the studies that they're doing is retrospective studies of the diagnosis of people who have died after being diagnosed as having schizophrenia. Meanwhile, they are completely failing to acknowledge that schizophrenia was developed in its diagnostic criteria and management strategies by the Nazis in the Second World War and earlier in the 1920s and earlier still by German racists in the 1890s who worked hand in hand with British racists in the 1890s, including Francis Galton himself, the father of eugenics. None of these Melbourne universities teach medical students anything about the genocide of Aboriginal people or the history of eugenics, let alone the history of the Freemasons. And the Masons in Australia continue to be a very secretive organization, even though there are a few websites that boast about how prominent Masons have included Winston Churchill and General Monash. The role of the Freemasons in slavery in particular is not mentioned, of course, by any Masonic publication. And there has never been a governmental admission that there was slavery instituted in Australia, both for the convict labor as well as Kanaka labor, Kanaka was a term for boy in a Pacific language. And in right through to the early 1900s, Queenslanders, including Townsville, after which Townsville is named, were involved in working as slaves, black boys who were kidnapped from the Solomon Islands and New Caledonia and New Guinea and the Torres Strait Islands, as well as Aboriginal boys. And they were working on the sugar plantations as slaves, but they called them indentured labor. This meant that they didn't get paid until they were ready to be sent back. In fact, many died, and some escaped, and some were deported during the institution of the White Australia policy to Fiji to continue working as slaves on British sugar plantations in Fiji. Meanwhile, the Aboriginal population were locked up in missions where they again were working as slaves, and they had whatever money they earned held and kept from them by the white runners of what were largely church-run missions. You can see that there's advertising on every page of the Melway, the Melbourne Street Directory. And most of this advertising, particularly in more recent editions, is from real estate companies. The The REIV is the Real Estate Institute of Victoria, and that's responsible for the training of real estate agents. The most recent editions of the Melway have hardly any ads, if any, that are not for real estate agents. The Melway also lists in this edition 41 Masonic lodges in Melbourne, and here you can see Professor's Walk, Professor's Road, the Conservatorium of Music, and Genetics Lane. And running north, you can see Medical Road. This is back at the University of Melbourne. You can see the Howard Florey Institute and the Medical Building. Now, if you look at the location of the various faculty buildings, they tell you a lot about the list of priorities and the history of Melbourne, of the fathers of Melbourne, and also the interests of the military. And there you can see Mason Road right in the middle, spelt with two S's, and Monash Road. Now, in addition to being one of the inventors of reinforced concrete and an engineer, General John Monash was also one of the icons of the Australian Jewish community. And if you look at the relationship between Jewish educational institutions and Monash University and Jewish doctors, particularly in the area of psychiatry, it becomes clear that the historical link between the Jewish community and Monash University have continued to the present day. This is a list of the actual buildings and departments in the University of Melbourne, which is a much older university than Monash University. And for many decades, in fact almost 100 years, was the only university in Victoria that were allowed to train medical students. All medical students in Australia learn that the main cause of schizophrenia is inherited. They also learn that cannabis causes schizophrenia or unmasks schizophrenia. And this is a key teaching of the Mental Health Research Institute at Parkville. And the Institute's director, Professor David Kopolov. Now, as has said the director of the Mental Health Research Institute is Professor Ben Lochtenberg, who also is the boss of the biggest producer of explosives for the mining industry in the world and a major producer of cyanide. Here you can see the different departments, including the Cunningham Dax Collection of Psychiatric Art. And this is the collection that was begun in the 1950s by Eric Cunningham Dax, a psychiatrist and the head of the government psychiatric services in the 1950s and 1960s. If you look at the board of management of the Mental Health Research Institute, you'll see there's Dr. Ben Lochtenberg. Now, he's not a medical doctor, he's an engineer, but he has a doctorate in philosophy. He is, though, primarily a company director, and the director also of an aluminium company, as well as Orica, or what at that stage was still the Imperial Chemical Industries, Australia. Director of Capital Aluminium and board member of the Inner and Eastern Healthcare Network, which, as you remember, was strongly supportive of the movement of the Fairfield Infectious Diseases Hospital Laboratory, renamed the Burnet Institute,